this seems like a movie poster that has been photoshopped, and I'll actually have some photographs here just to make sure that you all go home actually believing that I really went there, because I don't want to just talk about it and without showing any graphics, you actually go home and say, who was that guy? He was just claiming that he went there and stayed there for 16 months, and that too, it was like 20 years back, so I don't look 20 years old. So, I mean, going back there in 20 years back is something which is very different. So yes, there is a saying about it, no one goes to Antarctica casually. And that's a very profound statement, actually. Antarctica is the roughest continent known to mankind. It's probably the end of the world as far as Earth is concerned. I mean, up until 1820, we didn't even know that the Earth. Actually, Magellan did write about something that there was, he had a feeling that there was something down there, but only in 1820s people actually found Billinghausen when he was on his, and Lazarev when they were on the crew, they actually found that there is something down there actually. So I'll talk about, this is not a story about Antarctica, this is a story about some of the people who stayed at Antarctica through my eyes, and I'm going to relive it for you. So just a 101 of Antarctica. We have all seen this picture. This is one of the most magnificent pictures. I mean, I could look at this picture forever. And where this call out is there, that's where the Indian Permanent Station Maitreyi is. And that's where I stayed and lived there for 16 icy cold months. We all know it's coldest, windiest, fifth largest. It's a desert, actually. Because anything that gets less than 10 inches of precipitation or rainfall is technically called as a desert. You don't have desert safaris, though. You don't have wildlife photographers, though, but there is a very different kind of ecosystem at play over there. Now, one of the things about Antarctica is it's actually a very cross-functional, multidisciplinary kind of an expedition where people are drawn from, there are geologists, microbiologists, there are physiologists, there are meteorologists, all kind of people who are really coming there, and the primary aim is scientific research. We all know that ozone hole was discovered over there, but one of the funny thing about Antarctica is these are all the people who have all come together for the first time and started to live and behave like a team in a community setting. Now, we are all adult grown up and we have our own quirkiness, we have our own values, we have our own ways of doing things, but this is the time socialization becomes one of the most important things. So the toughest problems, in the last slide I talked about ice, and Antarctica is also known as the big ice. I mean, this is the biggest ice cube you can get on Earth, right? And ICE is also an acronym for actually isolation, confinement, and environment. And these are the three biggest enemies of people who actually winter over. And winter over is a term that actually means that you go there and you stay the entire austral winter there and come back the next year. So I went in 93 and came back in 95. So these three things are really, as I said, the isolation, you're staying away from your friends and families, you are staying in isolation, it gets onto your mind and plays tricks on you. You are living in a confinement. It is, if you have seen Survivor, if you have seen Big Boss, believe me, you still have a hope. Out there, if you die, they'll just bury you right there. That's about it. There's nothing more to it. You cannot get anything else. You don't get letters. Back when I was there, we used to get 6 minutes of telephone time per person per month. That's about it. There was hardly any, so Inmarsat had very small footprint and it had to go around the Earth and really be available for a very small amount of time. 94, when my colleague came to replace me, he installed internet over there. And that's when we got internet in the Indian station. So we didn't have internet at that time. So with these three problems, environment is a well-known problem. I mean, when you are living in minus 20, the lowest we saw was minus 33 degrees. And with the wind chill effect, so wind chill, it actually brings down the temperature to 4th degree of the temperature. So with wind chill, it was minus 70 degrees that we saw. It is something. I mean, minus 70 is something there. Environment is very harsh. You can have, suddenly the wind picks up and it gets into a blizzard and you have, I've been in a situation where I keep my hand here, my palm here, and there is so much of snow blowing there that I can't see my palm outside. So that's the level of snow blizzard and the kind of challenges are there. So the ship journey was really all about socialization because people are all coming together. Environment is one part of it, but really to deal with that long periods of isolation and confinement is really the biggest challenge there. So we use ship journey really as a place where people all got together. There were a lot of parties there. There was equator crossing party, there was New Year party, there was Christmas party, all kind of parties there. And two of the things that came pretty strong there was, you can judge people's character very well when there is free liquor available. And that was really very well tested there. I mean, we had people from all walks of life, We had people who were PhDs and double PhDs who were real scientists, and we had people who were expert in running generators and piston bullies and snow vehicles in minus 20 degrees. And the biggest challenge was to, we all came from different socio-economic walks of life, and how do we really behave together as a team? So the ship journey were for a large part was really spent in socializing and creating opportunities where people came together and they started really behaving like a team there. At the end of 21 days of sea journey, so we just boarded the ship from Goa and just we stopped at Mauritius for a day and just kept sailing down below, crossed the equator, came down to Roaring 40s, came down to Furious 50s, and then Antarctic Circle and saw some icebergs on the way. And none of them Titanic kind of iceberg, but then we just gracefully landed there. And what we found was Antarctica really is this huge polar ice sheet. Unlike the North Pole, there is a landmass underneath Antarctica, and we all know the Gondwanaland theory, where they were all together, Africa, Australia, India, and they broke up at some point in time, and India still actually drifted and banged into Africa, into Asia, and created the Himalayas, right? So geologists are very much interested because they see similar kind of properties, what they see, for example, on the coast of Orissa. They see similar kind of rock formation in Antarctica, for example. So Antarctica, as I said, is 99.7% covered with ice, and only 0.3% of Antarctica is ice-free, rocky terrain. Our station, we are lucky to be in one such place where there is rocky area because it is technically known as OSS. So in 30s, actually, the Germans flew down there and they've named a lot of mountains. So this mountain range is actually known as Schirmacher OSS. And OSS, like we know in desert, has water. And that's exactly why we call it OSS there in Antarctica also, because we actually have a freshwater lake. So you can actually see on the 5 o'clock of the slide, there is actually a freshwater lake visible. And the C shape is actually the main station, Metri. What you see on at 7 o'clock is really those summer huts, which were really the, well, I don't want to call them as the doghouse, but they were pretty close to that actually, because those were the places where there was no running water, let alone hot water. There was no heating there, and that's when you actually go there and settle down, because the team is already staying there in the station, and you start acclimatizing. You start acclimatizing for 22-hour days, because that's the summertime, and we have 2 months of light. We were at 70 degrees south. Just to give you a perspective, Norway is 70 degrees north, so we were actually like mirroring Norway in the South Pole. There were 2 months of continuous sunlight, so which would mean that there's almost 22 hours of sunlight, and for the remaining 2 or 3 hours in the day, there is a lot of ambient light, but not a direct sunlight there. The temperatures used to be +2, +3 degrees. In the night, it used to go to sub-zero, -4, -10 degrees kind of thing. And we all had to start working together as team and really start. So this was really the acclimatization phase. After some time, the summer team completed their work, and the old winter team, they all got back to the ship, and we actually moved in. Living in Antarctica in one single station, 25 men, there were no women. For those who might be interested to know, were there women there? There were no women there. But I was looking up on the website yesterday, actually, on the National Antarctic, and there were two women, actually, who wintered last year. And a couple of months back, somebody in Bangalore was in touch with me. She had applied for it, actually, and I was not sure, because normally the government of India, they say, okay, unless there are more than one, they don't allow that. But we were 25 men there. And one of the first things that you learn there is humility and teamwork. And that's something which is probably at the core of really what it takes to be an explorer. We had a cook there from the Navy, excellent cook. Incidentally, the cooks in Navy, they are taught how to make 2,500 dishes. I don't know if I can even name 25 dishes, let alone 2,500 dishes. So we all had to take turns and actually start. So I'll just talk about galley duty, which is, galley is the kitchen on ship, actually. And a galley duty is something that is biggest leveler of your ego in Antarctica. I mean, the place itself is humongous. The place is enormous. It's pristine beauty and its majestic presence there. It just makes you bow down your head and say, okay, hats off Mother Nature. I mean, you are something. But then the galley duty is yet another creation of mankind, which really brings, if at all you had any ego left by the time you hit Antarctica, comes to the bottom. So what you do is you get up 7 in the morning, there are 2 of you, you start brooming, sweeping, cleaning the entire floor, you hoover the whole floor, and then you start helping the cook. Like here, 2 of my teammates, they're actually helping the cook prepare the breakfast for 25 people. Just in time, you are done, and it's time to clean the toilets. It's time to clean the community toilets. We all take turns. I won't spend too much time on that because it's not something that I would like to relive again. But the toilets there have to be burnt, actually, because we have to carry everything back. You cannot leave anything in Antarctica. So you have to burn the solid waste, And it could be as demeaning as it gets, because you have to actually go down. Those are incinerator-based toilets, and sometimes they don't work, and you can imagine the rest, but you have to go and do a little bit of barbecue stuff there. If that is not enough, you have to collect the ashes, by the way, after that. You collect the ashes, you just take a quick shower. By the time you're ready to serve, to help the cook in serving the lunch for 25 people. Then you wash the vessels, not individual plates, but all the common vessels. You do that, and then by the time you're done, you get about 2 hours of sleep, start doing the same thing for at 7 o'clock, and then help the cook. And throughout the night, you're actually taking rounds throughout the station. You're checking the generator readings, you're checking the voltage readings, you're checking the fuel settings, till 7 in the morning there. And if that is not enough, cook has off on Sundays, so you actually make food for 25 people. And I've done that a couple of times there. It used to be a great experience. It was a wonderful experience to really be of help to the team members. Teaches you a lot in the life. The biggest challenge in Antarctica is not really physical. It's really the human spirit that we are dealing with. It's really the isolation. I talked about the ice things, three things, right? Isolation, confinement, environment. We can deal with environment. I've been in a situation where it was minus 20 degrees outside and I just go out in shorts and t-shirts and just take a stroll and come back, as long as there is zero wind. The moment there is even one knots of wind, it's just going to just blow through my body, that kind of thing. So we can deal with the environment, but the real biggest challenge was really dealing with the isolation and the confinement. And people undergo different mood swings. They undergo various kind of challenges when they are living alone. They have families back there. Somebody is not well. Somebody is studying. There were people with me. I was the youngest. I turned 25 at the continent there. But there were people who had school-going children. And there were people who had their real families back home who were dealing with real-life problems. The landlord is harassing somebody. The doctor, they have to, all kind of challenges that you can think of. And that is the single biggest thing that really, we had a problem. We even had an alcoholic in our team who would just go and take half a bottle in the night, and 3 o'clock he would just take out the drum set and invite to the biggest rock show in Antarctica. And then we had to actually declare off day next day, because people would get up at 3 o'clock and they can't do any work after that. They will go to sleep after the breakfast. So we had all kind of funny things, but the real challenge was, we were all real people who were dealing with. Dr. Lawrence from the University of California has done 4 decades of research in that, and he has actually analyzed how the various mood swing as they go with the expedition, how they really go. And midwinter is 21st of June when we celebrate, because that's 2 months of darkness. 1 month of darkness has already happened at that time. 21st June is when you celebrate in the Northern Hemisphere as the midsummer day. We celebrated that as the midwinter day. And then still another 1 month of darkness, and then it hits you. You know what? There is another 1 month of darkness to go. And the ship is not going to arrive for another 6 months there. You are living in a commune. You are living in a survivor island. You are where people cannot walk away. Nobody gets voted out. People would want to get voted out at some point in time, actually, because they'll just want to get out of that place and say, okay, enough of this. You can't. There's nobody who can come back and do. We have had challenges. There have been accidents. People have lost lives. 4 Indians have died. They died a couple of years back before we were there because of carbon monoxide poisoning. So all kind of dangers are there. But the real biggest danger is, how do you really make sure that people can stay motivated? How can we get them to really communicate and work with each other, collaborate with each other? And that's really the biggest learning that was there. So to basically counter that, we had to make sure that we actually spent enough amount of time socializing, really celebrating every single thing that was there. So we used to have these convoys. We were actually about 80, 90 nautical miles from the shelf. That's where the ship berths, and we had to dump all the luggage and fuel there. And in the winter, we actually run ground convoys. And we had to bring those big containers with 25,000 liters of fuel over, for example. We had to celebrate each and every single thing. There used to be situations where people have got stuck in a snow blizzard for 6 days. There is no radio contact. We don't know where are they. I was not able to get a lot of photographs, but there are photographs of whiteout, if you have heard of it. A whiteout is a condition right after the snow blizzard when the horizon is invisible. So the sky and the earth are of exactly same color, white color. And if you were walking on snow-filled ice, which could have hidden crevasses there, there is no milestone, there is no marker there. And plays on your eyes that you actually cannot, you lose the 3D sense of perception, actually. So you're not able to figure out if there is a cliff there, or if there's a crevasse there 10 meters down or 100 meters down there. So that's a kind of a challenge. And then when the convoy comes, it's like a party time over there. We had Russians nearby, and Russians were going through the breakup time. It was 93 when I was there, 91. They were going through the breakup time. There were Germans there after the unification, and they actually closed down the station. These Russians who came there were the people who literally lost their lives earning, because overnight ruble turned into rubble. And that was the biggest, single biggest challenge. And they were the warmest of the people there. I guess adversity brought all of us together, and we would celebrate. I mean, I learned all the 64 types of toasts that Russians propose, including to my neighbor's second wife's dog and stuff like that. So all kind of fun we used to have. I was the youngest guy, so I got to open maximum number of champagne bottles in line with the army tradition. So that was yet another achievement for me. So finally, when I look back at those crazy 16 months, I call them crazy because I volunteered for this expedition. And you have to be crazy to volunteer. I mean, you cannot be a regular guy there. You have to be absolutely crazy and nuts. Only then you would volunteer for something like this. And guess what? The first thing they do is they ask me to go to All India Institute of Medical Sciences, and they say, okay, you undergo a medical, surgical, and psychological examination. And psychological examination actually said you are fit to go. You are mentally in the right state of mind to go. And I said, come on, I cannot be. I mean, I'm mentally unstable. That's why I volunteered for that. And you're saying you're mentally stable for me to go there. So that was the kind of a contrast, really, because, I mean, you don't go there. You don't make money. You don't go for fame. You don't go for glory. People have already made glory out of it. You don't go for love unless penguin is your idea of love. And or unless you are loving, you're running away from love, in which case it might work for you. So why does one really go there? Why does one go there? I think it's the essence, it's the core of the human spirit. It's the core of people looking at themselves, getting up right in the first thing in the morning and looking at themselves in the mirror and saying, what do I really want to do? Is my idea of really challenging myself? Is it my idea of really pushing my limits? What do I really want to accomplish? There are some people who are great people who affect the societies and they create ideas there. There are some people who live for themselves and create a life around them. And then there are some people who are a little crazy. They are in between. They're not here. They're not there. They don't make impact to millions of people. But they take up some of those challenges which probably create some ideas, some experiences, some insights, some thing for them to hold on to for the rest of their lives, shape up their lives a little better there, and hopefully create the message of craziness to all the people. Because I was a software guy. I had no business to be there. I was a computer scientist in defense those days, and I said, well, I'm going to do software for the rest of the life. I'm going to talk to programming languages and machines for the rest of the life. Let me talk to the nature and learn something in that process. So that's my story of what I did in 16 months in Antarctica. Thank you for the audience. Thank you.